down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he, and together we sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with
Good morning and welcome to church, Covenant Church, whether you're here in person or watching electronically. A warm welcome to everyone, and thanks for the praise team for setting the tone and helping us to open this time in worship. Beautiful music, and we thank you for that. I don't have any announcements this morning, but we will be receiving greetings from other churches this morning. You will not see our greeting, Covenant Church, but the other churches will be able to see the greeting from Covenant Church. So if you're wondering why ours isn't up there, the other churches will see our greetings. So there will be greetings from churches this morning too. So may we have a blessed worship service together, and let's prepare our hearts and minds for that.
Well, good morning from Knox Presbyterian Church. My name is Ann Miller, and I've been the lay worship leader here for just over a year and a half, and we are joyfully anticipating in November a new minister coming to join with us. So it's a time of transition for us, and we are thinking of you on this Reformation Sunday, our brothers and sisters in the Reformed churches here in Woodstock, and we're missing having you here in the pews. We wish all good things for you. We hope that your congregations are thriving despite the pandemic. We hope that Jesus is becoming more and more known among you, as we pray that for ourselves as well. And just know that we're thinking of you on this day, and that we celebrate a common heritage and our history in the Reformed tradition of the church. And we are just so glad that you are with us in community here in Woodstock, and that God loves all of us. So we pray for you, we uphold our faith on this day, and we celebrate. May God be with you.
Good morning, friends, and greetings from friends and the saints over at Emmanuel Reformed Church on Clark Street. Even though we're separated physically this year, not being able to get together for Reformation Day service once again, we have more that holds us in common than our proximity to each other, and that is, of course, our faith in Jesus Christ and our heritage in the Reformation began by Martin Luther as he nailed those 95 theses to the church door at Wittenberg. So even though we can't be together to raise our voices together, to shake hands, to embrace one another, and praise our God for the salvation that he has given to us in Jesus Christ, know that we are praying for you, and we offer you this blessing. Comes from the book of Jude. Now to him who is able to protect you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory without blemish and with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time, now and forevermore. Amen. May this blessing be yours and in abundance through Jesus Christ. And as you worship together, may you know the tangible presence, guidance, and direction of his Holy Spirit, and may the love of God keep you always. Amen.
Good morning, and greetings from Maranatha CRC. We will miss being with you all again this year, and are holding out hope that next year we will be able to join together once again for our Reformation Day service. It is our prayer that God will bless you richly in your service today and in your kingdom work in the city of Woodstock. We would like to share with you this blessing adapted from Philippians 1, verses 3 to 11.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, we thank our God every time we remember you. In all our prayers for you, we always pray with joy because of your dedication to the gospel, from the first day until now.
Our God has begun this good work in you, and we are confident that he will carry it through until you are made complete in the day of Christ Jesus. Because we all share in God's grace together, we can be sure that our hearts are with you.
And this is our prayer, that your love may abound more and more in the knowledge of him who makes you pure and blameless. May you be filled with his righteousness to the glory and praise of our awesome God.
Rise for the call to worship. Today we're following the five solas, as was mentioned, and I think there's a handout at the back. And our call to worship starts with grace alone. It is from Ephesians 1, 3 to 8. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world, to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he has lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. Let us worship God. Let us celebrate his glorious grace.
Brothers and sisters, receive God's greeting to all in Woodstock who are loved by God and called to be saints. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people say, Amen. You may be seated. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, faith in the God who desires to forgive us of our sins. Let's go to him in prayer. Forgive our faithlessness, O God, O faithful God. Jesus, who sat at the table with outcasts and sinners, we confess that too often our words and actions are not consistent with our beliefs. Often we ignore the needy, show indifference to the lonely, and reject those who seem different from us. Forgive us, we pray. Enliven our faith, giving us eyes to see what you see and to live out what we believe day by day. Amen. Our assurance of pardon comes from Ephesians chapter 2. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God has prepared in advance for us to do. Brothers and sisters, as an affirmation of our faith, we'll recite the answer to question and answer 21 of the Catechism. What is true faith? Let's say that together. True faith is a sure knowledge whereby I accept as true all that God has revealed to us in his word. At the same time, it is a firm confidence that not only to others, but also to me, God has granted forgiveness of sins, everlasting righteousness, and salvation out of mere grace, only for the sake of Christ's merits. This faith the Holy Spirit works in my heart by the gospel.
Task unfinished that drives us to
Brothers and sisters, before we go to God in prayer, just want to update you or give you news about Veronica's brother, Carl, who is in ICU on a ventilator in Surrey, BC, Veronica. And with COVID, that's passed through the family, and thankfully, not many of them had any kind of serious symptoms, except for Carl is struggling in hospital, so we certainly go to our God and ask for him to restore Carl's health. And we think of Veronica, too, as she walks alongside from afar. Let's go to our God in prayer. Lord God, you are the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. You do not faint or grow weary, and your understanding is unsearchable. You give power to the faint. You strengthen the powerless. Even the young are faint and weary sometimes. They fall exhausted. But those who wait for you, Lord, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Heavenly Father, that is a powerful image and living reality. But as you know, we also have to answer the question, are we weak and heavy laden with yes a lot of the time? There are many in our church family who are weary and burdened and could use some rest. As we just mentioned, we go to you, lifting up Carl, asking you to sustain his health and restore him to health and to his family. Lord God, we pray that you would be with physicians and nurses and medical staff as they seek to bring healing to Carl and others throughout this country and this world as we continue to deal with the effects of COVID. Father, we think of Grace Haas and her ongoing journey with grief. We think of Bill and Kobe as Kobe recovers from recent surgery and as Bill struggles with declining health. We pray for Jenny Linnell as she recovers from her surgery. We think of Bill Vording, who experiences isolation and loneliness being in a nursing home farther away from Woodstock. Father, we continue to lift up Ed Hedinga and asking for your mercy and a measure of healing in his life. We pray for Cindy Veenstra's good friend Lori, who continues her battle with cancer and will start radiation treatment soon. We also remember Lori's father, who is also in hospital and will soon move into a nursing home, God willing. We lift up Ryan and Erica and their family and Lloyd and Elaine. And we ask for your sustaining and your healing mercies. Lord, we continue to come before your throne asking and pleading that you finish the good work that you've started. Lord God, we lift up prayers for your world, our world, especially places where there is hurting, chaos, and injustice. We pray for your children in Haiti, where gangs are blocking ports and cutting off access to fuel shipments. Hospitals on the verge of shutting down as generators run dry. People cannot communicate with loved ones as cell phone towers are without power. And people become more food insecure each and every day. We thank you for organizations like COTP who are there offering healing and help and hope. Oh Lord, please loosen the grip that hatred and cruelty have on human hearts. Bring solace to the weary, shelter to the vulnerable, freedom to the oppressed, mercy to the guilty, and love to the lonely. And may we, this church, be your hands and feet and ambassadors of your love and grace in whatever way you call us to. Gracious God, we reflect on the five solas today in this service. And we think of Scripture alone. And Lord Jesus, remember your words when the devil tempted you. And you said, we do not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry again for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in ways of eternal life. It's in Jesus Christ we pray, the bread of heaven, and all God's people say. Amen.
Scripture reading is Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Brothers and sisters, John Bunyan's famous book, A Pilgrim's Progress, tells of the main character, Christian, and his long spiritual journey from the city of destruction to the celestial city. The story begins with Christian weighed down by the great burden of his sin and the fearful judgment to come. But the character evangelist comes to tell Christian how to enter the narrow way of salvation, where his burden can be taken away. Shortly after beginning his pilgrimage, Christian meets a man who tells him of a faster way to get rid of his burden. All Christian needs to do is to go and see a gentleman named Legality, who lives in the village of morality. To put this in spiritual terms, he could get rid of his sins simply by keeping God's law. Salvation not by grace alone, through faith alone, but through keeping God's law alone. Christian is intrigued by the possibility. But could Mr. Legality really help him get rid of his burden? When Christian asks the way to morality, the man answers by pointing to a high mountain and saying, "By that hill you must go." When Christian reaches the hill, he's overwhelmed by the size of it. And he's terrified when he sees the flashes of lightning and the fire coming out of it. Christian is so afraid that his burden now seems heavier than ever. Now, Bunyan doesn't mention this hill by name, but it's not hard to guess which hill he has in mind. The hill of fire and smoke is Sinai, the mountain of God's law. Like Christian, the Israelites were also terrified at the foot of Mount Sinai. And here's the thing, brothers and sisters, the Israelites probably didn't come close to realizing the full extent of God's law. Undoubtedly, there were some things about the Ten Commandments that they didn't quite understand. How each commandment is both positive and negative, and how it governs inward attitudes as well as outward actions. Or how each commandment is representative of a larger category of sin and duty. But here is something they probably did understand. Their God was making an absolute claim on them. They belonged to him, body and soul. He demanded their all of their worship, all of their time, their relationships, their possessions, their bodies, their speech, even their desires. In Leviticus 19, the Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the entire assembly of Israel and say to them, 'Be holy, because I, the Lord your God, am holy.'" Talk about a terrifying, righteous standard for all of life. Anyone up for that climb? Well, 5 years ago now, Deb and I arrived at the base of Mount Sinai, and we were also frightened. There wasn't any smoke or fire coming from the mountain, but it looked pretty daunting to us. Deb gave me permission to share her story about her pilgrimage up Sinai. There was a point in time after about an hour or so of climbing that our shepherd George told us, "It only gets harder from here. So if you need to turn back, now would be the time." Reverend Dirk Miedema is the man in the picture in front of Deb. At this point, three people decided to turn back. And the rest of us carried on with a modern-day yoke attached to us, a backpack. Ours, brothers and sisters, was full and heavy. Now, about 45 minutes or so later, Deb, who has struggles with occasional breathing issues, was pretty much out of breath. And she thought to herself, "There's no way I'm going to make it." So word got to George at the very front of the line, and he came back to find out what was going on. Deb shared how she didn't think she could carry on, and George pulls out his inhaler. "Here, take two hits of this for starters." And then George looked straight in Deb's eyes and said, "I believe that God has a portion that all of us will make it up that hill." Now, I don't know if that was some kind of revelation or not, but it encouraged Deb because her response was, "Okay, let's go." So Deb and I went to the front of the group. I carried her water pack, and one of the Bedouin guides carried her backpack. But the thing that I believe contributed most to Deb making it up that mountain was George, our shepherd, walking with Deb many times, hand in hand, side by side, up that mountain. And then for the last hour or so of the climb, because I think that George couldn't keep up with Deb at this point, George handed Deb off to another Bedouin guide named Hussein. Hussein then took Deb by the hand and led her the rest of the way up the mountain. And I asked Deb at one point if she wanted me to help her, and she said, "No, I want Hussein." Now, why was I ditched for Hussein? Because Deb knew that Hussein knew the way. He had climbed that mountain before. And Hussein set the pace. His mantra to Deb was, "Slowly, slowly." And we received the benefit because we all then went slowly. Slowly, but surely. Deb and the rest of us made it up that mountain the final 2 hours in pitch darkness with our little flashlights as a lamp unto our feet and a light on our path. Now, there were also a lot of prayers being lifted up. You could feel them. Prayers for Deb, prayers for ourselves, because we were all extremely weary and burdened, and we couldn't wait for some rest. But minute by minute and step by step, not really knowing how much further, we finally did see the fire on top of Sinai. It was the fire our Bedouin hosts had made for us with fresh coffee and the best stew you'd ever tasted. Unless, of course, you were the only vegetarian on the trip. There were some other food there too. Deb didn't starve. We were just so thankful that the words of our shepherd proved to be true. It was God's portion for every one of us to make it. I share this story, brothers and sisters, because as I reflect on this text from Matthew 11, I can say from experience that the words of Jesus, the good shepherd, proved to be true. I saw it most clearly through Deb and her pilgrim's progress. In Deb, I saw every one of us. I witnessed the humility it takes to stop and cry out for help when it's needed. In George, I saw Jesus, our good shepherd, who knows every one of his sheep and who speaks timely words of encouragement that are always true. And in Hussein, that quiet but steady Bedouin guide, I saw the Holy Spirit, the successor to Jesus, the one Jesus sent after the ascension to be his power and his presence with us, our guide for the journey that lay before us. And in the people of that climb, I saw a beautiful picture of the body of Christ praying together, staying together, and carrying each other's burdens all the way up that rocky and narrow way. And I saw how important it is to stay close to the shepherd, to hear his voice, and to keep in step with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, our own personal inhaler, who not only gives us the breath of life, but who is the breath of life. And all these things, I saw what Jesus meant when he said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. He didn't say our yoke was easy or our burden is light. He said his was. He knows that every single one of us carries our backpacks, and he knows that we are weary and burdened more than we need to be. That's why he comes to us and says, come to me. Come to me, all you weary and burdened ones. I will give you rest. Now, when Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, we often think of that yoke that a pair of oxen wears. And I certainly think that's a fitting image. If that's what Jesus has in mind, you could translate the verse by saying, yoke yourself with me, for my task for you is shared and made easy, and the burden is light. And while I think that is also true, I believe the yoke that Jesus has in mind is the yoke of his teaching. In Jesus' day, rabbis invited people to learn to keep the Torah. This was called taking the yoke of Torah, or the yoke of the kingdom of heaven. So rabbis would have different interpretations or yokes. Torah teachers would teach the accepted interpretations or yoke of their community of followers. So in that light, Jesus' invitation to those who listened to many other interpretations of God's law helps him establish himself as the rabbi with a new interpretation. And what's easy and light in this case is the understanding of Jesus' interpretation of the law with the illumination of the Holy Spirit, not necessarily the burden. And we have this new teaching, this new understanding in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, don't we? Remember in the Sermon on the Mount how Jesus would take some previous law like adultery and say, you have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you, anyone who looks lustfully at a woman has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Your right eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Okay, thanks, Jesus. That's much easier to follow. Not. And all through the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus turns the law inside out, reminding us that we not only have to obey the law to the letter, but our heart has to be in the right place too. And if that's not terrifying enough when it comes to the righteous standard of living in God's kingdom, how about Jesus' application to the Sermon on the Mount? The last verse of chapter 5. Verse 48, where Jesus says, be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Anyone up for that climb? And doesn't this be perfect language remind us of someone? Sure it does. It reminds us of the God of the Old Testament who said, be holy as the Lord your God is holy. Now, I don't know about you, but when I hear the righteous standard of living in God's kingdom, it terrifies me. So how can we find rest for our weary souls? And how can we live up to these impossible righteous requirements of God the Father and now God the Son? Like Deb, I think I'm going to have to just stop and say, I can't do it. Can't make it. Help, Lord. Help. Well, don't look now. But here comes Jesus from the top of that hill. Here comes the Good Shepherd, and he has more than a puffer for you and for me. Jesus has some living words, some sola scriptura. And this is what Jesus says. Do you know what, John? You're absolutely right. You can't keep the righteous requirements of God. But God requires that someone does on your behalf. And that someone has to live that perfect life, loving God with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength, and loving his neighbor as he loves himself. And that someone will have to take all of the backpacks of every single person who's ever lived on his back up a different hill. The hill outside of Jerusalem called Calvary. And on this hill, the Messiah will be pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. But by his wounds, we are healed. Brothers and sisters, salvation is by grace alone, through faith in what Jesus Christ did alone. It was Jesus who lived a perfect, righteous life on our behalf, our representative, our mediator. Jesus, the second Adam, did what the first Adam failed to do. Jesus was holy as the Lord God is holy. Jesus was perfect as his heavenly Father is perfect. And in this new covenant, which really isn't a whole lot different from the old covenant, the righteous still live by faith and not by works. We live by faith in the work that Christ has done on our behalf. Jesus and the Holy Spirit have been there. They've done that. They know the way. So how can we find rest for our burdened souls? The same way the Old Testament saints did. They had faith in the promises of God and in the coming Messiah. And we have faith in the Messiah who came, the greatest promise of God ever. And we strive to be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect, not to earn anything. That's already been done. But we strive to be like Jesus. We strive to be how God already sees us, as perfect. And now, out of sheer gratitude, thanksgiving, and only with the help of Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit within us, we, like Deb, say, okay, let's go. Knowing that we have a personal guide, far more steady, far more experienced, far more helpful and powerful than the Bedouin shepherd Hussein could ever be. Because the Holy Spirit not only takes our hand on the outside, but transforms us from the inside. And the Holy Spirit reminds us all of what Jesus, our wonderful rabbi and good shepherd, teaches us. So for our application this Reformation Sunday morning, let's do what our Lord and Savior calls us to do. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Taking Jesus' yoke means that we allow him to examine our backpacks. Wow, says Jesus, this is heavy and burdensome. I wonder what's in it. What's this doing here? This is guilt and shame from things I've long since forgiven. That doesn't belong. Those were washed in the blood of Christ, remember? Well, now this is something different. Unconfessed sin. I've been waiting for you to ask for forgiveness on this. Three honest words, please forgive me. And I'll put that with the rest of your forgiven sin. Oh, what about this heavy burden? It goes by many names. Cancer, heart disease, dementia, loneliness, depression. There's too many to count. Can you take this one, Jesus? In good time, my son. In good time, my daughter. But for now, I will help you carry it. Not only that, you can make that one lighter. Did you know that? How, Lord? How? This burden is made bigger because it contains the fears and the worst case scenarios that go way off into the future. Last I checked, you don't hold the future in your hands. I do. So let's make this one a little bit smaller. Let's just carry one day of cancer for today. One day of dementia. One day of depression. Don't worry about tomorrow. Today has enough trouble on its own. Step by step, remember? Day by day. Remember what Hussein said to Deb. Slowly now. Slowly. Just focus on that next step. And remember who has you by the hand. And will carry you if need be. Okay? Brothers and sisters, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to our God in prayer. Let's do that now. Oh Lord, our gracious God, our Heavenly Father, on this Reformation Sunday, We are so thankful to be reminded again of the good news that we find in Scripture alone. That we are saved not by any good works of our own, but that we are saved by grace through faith in who our good, good shepherd is and what he did for us. He laid down his life for the sheep. Oh God, this was all for your glory, so that your name would be hallowed and known in all the earth. We are so glad that you allow us to share in that glory as your beloved, your bride. Thank you, God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all God's people say, Amen. Brothers and sisters, orthodoxy, which is right belief, should always lead to orthopraxy, which is right living. Part of the joy we have is to give to those who are in need. I think our offering is for Sakura House. Do you have a slide for that one? No? Does anyone, deacons, know? Is it Sakura House this morning? Yes? Okay. Let's pray. Oh Lord, God and Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for Sakura House, this much-needed hospice in Woodstock. Lord, we pray that others could open. Lord, it's such a tender and difficult and intimate time as we walk alongside our loved ones near that the last stages of their life. And Lord, we're just thankful for organizations that are full of compassion and take away some of the logistics and the little burdens that we have, Lord, so that we can just focus on our loved one and just spend our last days and hours and minutes with them. Lord, we pray a blessing on Sakura House and all organizations like that. And we pray a blessing on this church as we continue to be able to give to the ministries of this church and as we continue to faithfully preach your gospel, Lord, the right beliefs, but also to live that out through right Christian practice. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. To the glory of God alone is the final sola. God sends us out with his blessing. Ephesians 3. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people say, Amen.